I'd like to move to the next traditional portion of ISDH, which is called Reports of the Nations. And I've contacted many of you to come up and give a brief report on the state of holography in your country. There are probably some people here who have shown up who didn't pre-register, who are from countries we didn't know about last week. So if you don't hear your country named, even if you're not prepared to give a report, we'd just like you to stand up and recognize that your country is represented. So I'll do this in alphabetical order, at least rough alphabetical order, and that means that Paula Dawson gets to start with Australia.
Hi, everyone. Lovely to see you all. I'm just going to report briefly on three areas in Australia: artists, galleries, and courses. Margaret Bennion, who now lives on the outskirts of Sydney's work, continues to be a very important influence. An early laser transmission work of hers has been shown recently in a group exhibition on the theme of the environment at Macquarie University Gallery. Margaret has donated White Rainbow, Tiresias, and Counting the Beats to the Newcastle Gallery. And five more of Margaret's works have joined the other two pieces previously acquired by the National Gallery of Australia. Congratulations to Martina Mongrovius on the completion of her PhD on holography through the Spatial Information Architecture Laboratory within RMIT University School of Architecture Design, and her exhibition Post-X in Ghent, Belgium. Melinda Menning, who has recently graduated with a master's degree in education, is also nearing the completion of her PhD on art and holography at Macquarie University. Dave Warren has produced a new major 1 kilometre long by 3.5 centimetre wide white light transmission achromatic hologram titled Hallelujah on the theme of Twitter. Amy Rush has been continuing with the Love Motel project and has received funding for new skills in holography from the Australia Council for the Arts. Linnea Rundgren has been working collaboratively with Nils Abramson on displacement and distortion and ways to display medium to large scale holographic images of small objects, and this is part of her Bachelor of Scientific Photography at RMIT. The National Gallery of Australia is continuing, its pioneering interest and support of the medium. The senior curator of photography, Gail Newton, has listed 14 works in the collection, 8 by Margaret Bennion, 1 by me, 3 by Robin Beach and Edwina Orr, and 2 by Xu Min Lin. And she's indicated that she anticipates that more 3D work in various formats will be acquired in the future. Gallery M in South Australia has exhibited Dave Warren's new work. The Newcastle Gallery commissioned a portrait of the much-loved art patron Anne Lewis, and the director Ron Ramsey co-curated a major retrospective of my holographic works together with director Rhonda Davis and a collaborative team at the Macquarie University Gallery. Andrea Wise, the senior paper conservator of the National Gallery of Australia, has written a paper outlining conservation issues relevant to the reflection and transmission holograms in the collection. Andrea will present this paper at the Australian Institute for Conservation of Cultural Materials conference in Brisbane, and will continue seeking analytical methods to determine types of deterioration with a postdoc physics student at the Australian National University, Canberra. Phil Wilkes, School of Applied Physics, RMIT, has supervised projects in the design of holographic optical elements for the reduction of lens aberrations and for optical trapping of colloidal particles in multiple locations for study of crystallization processes. At RMIT, as part of a building refurbishment program, the Holography Lab has moved to new premises, and the elective courses on holography for science students has not run for the past few years because of resource restrictions and policies to do with minimum class sizes. Patrick McMillan continues to teach the elective in optical holography to physics students at the University of New South Wales. At the College of Fine Arts, the fully online digital hologram course has been taught twice by Leo Martin despite low student enrollment numbers. And a fully online optical hologram course has also been prepared. However, it hasn't run due to changes in the laser safety standards in Australia. A five-year research project to develop real and virtual tools to make hand-drawn content for holograms with collaborators Masataka Tsuka, Hiroshi Yoshikawa, Brian Rogers and myself is funded by the Australian Research Council. And finally, one of the highlights was the extended visit by Hiroshi Yoshikawa to Sydney to collaborate with researchers at the Australian National Fabrication Facility at the University of New South Wales. Thank you.
We have, I believe, an attendee from Belgium. I don't think we have a report from Belgium, but we'd like to recognize Belgium. Richard? I think the next one in order is Canada. Melissa?
I didn't realize I wasn't supposed to do a PowerPoint, but anyway. Anyway, hi everybody. I was asked to give an update on activities in Canada in holography. So this will be things that have taken place since Shenzhen in 2009. And okay, good. I've got a thing here. One of the really interesting things that happened was in 2010, Theodore Maiman, who built the very first laser, retired to Vancouver, and they celebrated the 50th anniversary of the actual physical building of that laser, and they had an event there. And Gary Cullen, who is this fellow up here, some of you know him, he had this very successful company, Holocrafts, for many, many years. And Gary did the laser transmission hologram of this first laser. The laser is real cute. It's like a little bitty thing about that size, and it's a pulse laser. And the box has a little diode in it, and so you can illuminate it. And they actually fired the laser off, and it still works. So that was a neat thing that happened. Rabbit holes. I'm not completely sure what happened to rabbit holes. Rabbit holes was, what's wrong? Oh, how did I end up with two? Oh, it's stereo, anyway. Rabbit holes is this company that it's had a lot of iterations, and they did the big avatar holograms. They did some really amazing holograms from 3D movie film, and I don't know, they had closed down a year or so ago, and then I just heard a rumor that they may be reopening up again in Toronto. So I still have my day job. I work for Lidolite, which was bought by Philips, and we're still doing the whole meso-optics, which are the optical diffusers. A lot of holographic technology behind that goes into luminaires, and that continues to thrive and has been very successful. Michael Page is here. I didn't get any slides from him, but Michael's been really active in Canada forever. He's very involved in education at the University of Toronto, teaches holography courses, continues to stay very, very active in promoting and keeping art holography in particular going in Canada. We have with us Jacques Debiens. He does very extravagant computer-generated holography, and you'll see some of his work here this week. Jacques is from Quebec, and he continues to work and do a lot of art holography. It's another one of his pieces. Mary Harmon's with us this week. Mary continues to be an amazing artist. She was recently in the Art of Shaping Light show in Butler, New York. She also had a show at the Butler Museum of American Art in the last year or so. And Mary makes a lot of really interesting combinations of holograms in kind of Cornell box type arrangements. Philippe Boissonnet, who I think is here, is also very active in Eastern Canada as an educator and a very prolific artist in holography. He continues to show extensively. We have Georges Dienz, who I think is also supposed to be here. Georges also continues to just produce and show a lot of artwork. I think maybe Canada and Australia have the same sort of number of art holographers per capita, but it's quite amazing how much art is still going on in those countries. And then, last but not least, there's a group of holographers in Vancouver. Al Rizzutis was very involved in the very early days of holography, but he's a bit of a phantom in terms of the community. And then there was Gary Cullen, who had the very successful holographs. Bern Simpson, who had taught holography in the physics department at Cap University, and myself. We got together in 2010 and had a barbecue and decided we'd do a show. And so we rented an industrial space, and we just all got together. We had all of Gary's 3D camera collection, a lot of my artwork, a lot of Al's artwork, and we set up a demonstration lab to show people how to make holograms. And we even did there was a 3D video projection of fractals. So it was really great fun. We all paid for it, and it was very well attended. That's it. Thank you.
Right. And next we have China, and representing China will be Frank, who was our host in 2009.
I'd like to take this opportunity to introduce the holography in China. First, the government policies inspired the holography for 3D displays in the 12th five-year plan of National Science and Technology. Chinese government encourages holography researches for real 3D display as a new type of display holography, display technology in the future. It is the first time in recent 10 years that holography is definitely supported by the Chinese government project technology. The HoloTV system invented by AFC Technologies Corporation Limited has got 2.5 million RMB financial support for further innovation. This work has been published on optics after it's first demonstrated at the 8th International Symposium on Display Holography in Shenzhen, China. It was also It was also reported and commented by Scientific American, Optics and Photonics News, and so many optics website. Related works and further explanations are also published on Applied Optics, Optic Express, etc. The second is the traditional hologram industries encounter big challenges in both hologram industries have developed so rapidly that in China, holograms are emerged into various merchandise more or less, from small logos to the integral packagings aimed at security and promotion. It is a trend for this market that the packaging industry more properly as a special color for colorful printing, But the unexpected deformation caused by the traditional thermal embossing technology makes it impossible to register the holographic pattern with the printing colors in high precision. That's why the price of present hologram film decreases to the edge profit for example, the metallized shimmless big rainbow BOPP film decreases to 0.5 RMB per square meters, less than half of this price 1 year ago. The third, UV casting techniques bring a new chance for holographic packaging. UV casting technologies can overlap the deformations effectively because no temperature is needed. It can also precisely produce three-dimensional nanometer structures with much huger dynamic ranges than the traditional thermal embossing. Therefore, to produce microstructure such as Fresnel lens, now we can arrange different type of holographic element in the same master by UV recombining to make each specified element precisely registered to the afterworld printing colors. This master can be used for UV embossing to produce the no deformed film for the final product of registered hologram papers. Such papers is widely used in the packaging of Chinese wine. See the following examples. Yeah, this is a registered holographic paper produced in AFC. Finally, I will show some for the people who didn't attend the ACE ISDH, I like to show some video effect here. Yeah, this is our Holo TV systems, real time. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Frank. I believe we have someone attending from Colombia. Are you here? So, thank you. I don't know if you have anything to say about holography in Colombia, but. So the next is the Czech Republic.
Okay, so good morning, everybody. My name is Marek Škereň. I'm from Czech Technical University. And I would like to say a few words about holography in Czech Republic today. Czech Republic is a much smaller country than Australia and China, and these countries we heard about it recently. It has only 10 million people, but still there are quite a few subjects dealing with holography. So when I was thinking about the companies and universities, I counted these 9 subjects. If I should tell a few words about each, I will start with Czech Technical University. Which is my organization. There is a group of optical physics led by Professor Pavel Fiala, who was used to attend this ISDA meeting in 80s and 90s of last century, but unfortunately he couldn't come today. So we have more than 30 years history in holography. We are still working in image holography. We are preparing our own recording materials. My colleague Milan Kvetoň will give a talk about materials on Wednesday. We are also working in synthetic holography. We are recently dealing with techniques like laser writing and electron beam writing applied for fabrication of synthetic holograms. And we are working also on some applications. You will also hear talk of my colleague Jakub Svoboda on Thursday and my talk about synthetic holograms for security applications on Friday. We also have education in holography. We have a study program, optical physics, within which there are some lectures about holography. As far as I know, we are the only group dealing with holography in such a complex way. All the others are focusing on some specific problems. For example, University of West Bohemia, there is a small group represented here on ISDH by Peter Lobaz, who will have his talk on Wednesday or Thursday, I think. And he's dealing with digital light propagation calculations. And there are three other groups at the Technical University in Liberec. There is a group of Wiet Ledl, who is dealing with holographic interferometry. A similar topic is also researched at Palackie University in Olomouc by Professor Boucha. And then there is a group of Radim Chmelík in Brno at Technical University, who is dealing with holographic microscopy. From commercial point of view, there are, I think, four companies today which are still making holograms. Of course, there are many much others, but they are only reselling holograms from foreign producers. So these four companies are named here. The first and the youngest one is Holoplus, which was founded in 2010 and is closely cooperating with our institute, with Czech Technical University. So they are offering image holograms of large formats, embossed holograms. They are developing laser writers for synthetic holograms and doing some scientific applications also. Then there is a quite big company, Optaglio, quite well-known company, which is oriented on security elements, security applications, and they are focused on electron beam lithography applied for high-resolution synthetic holograms. And then there are two other companies which are not doing their mastering, but they are embossing holograms. The first one is Philag company, which for almost 20 years is developing and producing machines for holography, some embossing machines and machines for application of hot stamping holograms. And today they are also offering wide variety of embossed holograms produced in large volumes. And the last company is Lightgate company, which is also oriented in this field of security holograms. Okay, so I think that's all.
Thank you. I think we have at least one attendee from France, although I don't know that we have a report. Thank you. Next is Germany. I'm not sure which of you is going to give this.
Hi, I'm representing the University of Cologne, which has a holography lab. I'm here with Martina Mongrovius and Guillermo Heinze. Holography in Germany is an active part of a number of institutions and companies with the development of commercial products, as well being engaged in reach and being engagement in reach and artistic projects. In 2010, Bayer Materials Science launched a new class of photopolymer materials under the trademark Bifol HX. The standard grade is a panchromatic material which can record volume holograms and requires no chemical processing after exposure. Biomaterial science is working with a number of industries and research partners to develop industrial and consumer applications. Pronova continues to make HoloPro holographic screens for video projection. The screens are printed as an array of holographic optical elements, which direct the light from a video projector into viewing area. The individual holographic optical elements that make up these screens are now much smaller than the pixel resolution of video projectors. Beside many other screens, three HoloPro were installed in 2011 as a part of an extensive renovation of Moscow's planetarium. Pronova also continues to develop dot matrix holosigns. Michael Bleinberg created a new series of artwork using multi-channel holosigns. These works were presented at the Gallery 822 in Budapest as a part of light event by the International Kepisch Society in 2011. The Fraunhofer Institute in Berlin developed an autostereoscopic display, which is now commercially available through real eyes. holographic displays are also being investigated. However, none of this research has yet been published. The Institute also uses holography as an analysis tool. At Cologne University of Applied Science, physical optics and holography is one of the researchers and learning laboratories, with most of their research focused on optical measurement techniques. Also, holography as a tool for material analysis, the electron microscopy and electron holography workgroup at the Technical University Berlin moved to a new disturbance resilient building in 2011. The Academy of Media Arts Cologne has a holography laboratory founded by panel member Professor Dieter Jung, and we are currently reaching how to enable the next generation of artists to work with new holographic technologies. In December 2009, Matthias Lauck passed away. Lauck was a prolific and passionate collector of holography. He established Museum for Holography and New Media in Pulheim in 1979. His memoir, I Saw the Light, is available in German. Thank you.
Thank you. I think the next country is Greece.
Hey, everybody. I don't know if I will have access to... fails, I will still do it verbally anyhow. I think that I need to do very much introduction into Greece. You know where the country is. You have in the news, not in a positive way, unfortunately, just 4 or 5 years. As a matter of fact, things have not changed. We are still in the news. But this time tonight, I mean today, here I guess for... here for... the resolution is not right, so I cannot actually get into that part. Still, you will see it from this way. Okay, well, let me go one slide back, because I would like to introduce our holographer, because myself, in spite of the appearance, I'm not a holographer. I have Andreas somewhere back there. Andreas, please stand up. Andreas Sarakinos is our holographer. He has been in holography for the last 25 years. You will read his paper in the presentation later this week, and you will see his hologram at the MIT Museum exhibition. Now, this about Greece, as I said, we have been in the news negatively for the last few years. Now, what this has accumulated, this economic recession, clearly has had its impact on everybody. And with an accumulative GDP reduction of minus 20%, actually, we shouldn't be here. However, this being our first ISDH conference, we are very pleased to be here, and we would like to report on what is going on in Greece, not what has been going on, but what is going on. Now, in Athens, we have a couple of academic research laboratories, one being in the Technical University of Athens by Aravantinos in the School of Photography, and also we have another laboratory at the Metsovion Polytechnic School. Now, in the city of Ioannina, there is a brave man who has a very huge holographic table, who has been able to do display holography, conventional and very analog, up to 30 by 40. And down in Crete, there is some more interesting activity going on, and you will see a little bit more of this later on. The Institute of Electronic Structure and Laser at the Foundation of Research and Technology, for those of you who are in this field, is a very well-known institution around the world. And Tsiranidou, Elsa Tsiranidou, she has been doing optical holography lab work there. But more importantly, Vivi Tornari, who has been doing a lot of work in spectral interferometry, and you will see it also a little bit more of this, is active. And I didn't have Thessaloniki up until this morning because I didn't know what was happening with our friends out there. But Xanthippos Vissios, who has an artistic approach, and he's doing what he calls special drawing, is among us today here. And I was very pleased to see him after really 24 years for the first time, because I've lost track of him, but he's here. Now, our institute, and there you see how holography is spelt in Greek, for those of you who haven't seen it, is active since 87. And it is a privately financed institution, which means we finance it from collateral income from security applications. My presentation here today in this report is not about that, because we think that this is more display related, so I will not bore you with the security aspects or other commercial aspects of holography in Greece. Anyhow, our focus of the institute now is on applied holography in cultural heritage. And we started a program back in 2009 called Holocultura for the preservation, recording, and dissemination of virtual artifacts of cultural heritage. We set up the Z Lab, as we call it, and this is a transportable lab for in situ recording of Denisuk holograms. You will hear more of this on Wednesday. And actually, one of the samples of our work is exhibited at the museum. Now, a little bit more about Crete, optical holography. You can see holograms up there from ELSA. And this is for those of you who happen to know Vivi as a holographer, because she graduated from the Royal College of Arts in the UK. So she's well known. But what she has done, more importantly, she has developed a portable system for structural diagnosis of artworks by using digital holography in speculative ferrometric patterns. And let me give you a little bit of information on this, because that's actually the first in the world. And she has been doing quite interesting work with El Greco paintings, Raffaello paintings, and different frescoes in France and Croatia and the rest. Now, this is where we come into a joint cooperation. And again, you will hear a little bit more of this on Wednesday with Crete. And please remember Crete. It's a very interesting venue. And maybe one day, as ISDH keeps traveling around the world, maybe you end up down there in Crete, so I'm sure you will enjoy that. Now, they have developed, and they have a large number of international publications, scientific publications, more than 100 in art conservation, with spectral imaging tools, with laser-induced backscattering and breakdown spectroscopy, with structural diagnostic tools, as we just said, for speculative ferrometry. And of course, they do a lot of laser cleaning, and they have been doing work for the Guggenheim Museum, for Acropolis. You can see the systems, UV and infrared lasers cleaning up the caryatids in Acropolis Museum right now, live. Now, this is where we come in, and we think that our camera, the transportable system that we have developed for the in-situ holographic recording of cultural artifacts, is interesting. And together with this, we think we have a new novel approach towards this cultural heritage story, which is a long story ever since holography came out into public. But we think that now we have a more integrated scientific approach together with whatever is happening for the conservation of art. And also we have a different audience, because now, for instance, just last week, we were in Crete and we gave a presentation on what is going on in holography to an audience from this multidisciplinary organization from Europe, which involves from the British Museum down to everybody, I mean, really involved in holography or really involved in conservation of art in Europe, and who isn't. And with this, I thank you.
Thank you. Next is Italy. And I believe Dora Tassinari is going to say a few words. No remarks, just recognize that we have an attendee from Italy. Thank you. Let's see, India. I believe we have some attendees from India here. Welcome. And I think there will be probably some papers. Some papers on the work you're doing there. Japan. Hiroshi, you have a presentation for us, I think.
Good morning. I'm Hiroshi Yoshika from Nihon University, Japan. And I have a few topics. First one is standardization. Oh, it's very hard to me. And two standards on holography. The first one is a method of measuring refraction efficiency and associated optical characteristics of hologram. And the second one is a method for measurement on holography recording characteristics. So these two standards has been registered to Japanese industrial standard on January last year. And It is also submitted to ISO International Standard as working draft on February this year. So we hope we can make international standard within 3 years. And next topic is a publication of the book entitled Development of Holography in Japan. It's Japanese version of holographic vision, and it includes technology, business, and art from 60s to 2010. And the half part is the Professor Mitamura's interview to 26 holographers in Japan. And the book is edited by some members of HODIC, Japanese Holographic Society. And editor-in-chief is Dr. Fujio Iwata. Unfortunately, the book is written in Japanese, but it's available from Japanese company, not from Amazon. Yeah, because Amazon takes a very high rate of the commission, so the publisher doesn't like that. Anyway, we have two international conferences in Japan last year. First one is an international workshop on holography and holography and related technologies, and was held in Utsunomiya City last November. And the other one is the OSA's topical meeting on digital holography and three-dimensional imaging. And it was held in Tokyo on May 2011. And the last topic is the sad news. Dr. Akira Tonomura passed away on May 2nd. And he's not working on holographic display, but working, he developed holographic electron microscope and verified an Aharonov-Bohm effect. And his recent achievement can be found at this site. And one more thing is news about the conference, not in Japan, but OSA's topical meeting, digital holography and three-dimensional imaging, 2013 will be held in Hawaii. And I will be a chair, so I want many of you publish your work at the conference and see you at Hawaii. Okay, that's it.
Next is Korea, and I believe Minji Kang is going to present.
Good morning. How are you today? I hope all of you are enjoying this ISDH today. Oh my God. Sorry about that. My name is Minji Kang. I'm a student of hologram in Kwangun University, and I am giving a presentation on behalf of my professor called Sung Hyun Lee. Actually, our department is gaining a lot of governmental funding since Korean government consider it hologram as a very promising area. So government is very dedicated to boost industry of hologram. Okay. Korea has established world-class level of high-speed telecommunication infrastructure. For example, CDMA was commercialized in Korea first in the world. So also you can enjoy high-speed internet wherever you go in Korea. So even in your very remote places, you can get wireless, a very fast wireless internet. And also 3D display industries are developing remarkably. There are two top companies called Samsung and LG. Samsung is making shutter glass 3D display, and LG is making polarized. Especially, LG is not only making just TV, but also making a mobile phone. So if you can shoot with this mobile devices, and you can watch the film with your laptop computer and TV and desktops. As I told you, the current government is giving enormous funding to hologram industry. So many venture companies and many big companies also get funding, and they are struggling to research on this hologram. So another example is by 2016, Korea is to plan to open digital culture museum. So you can enjoy hologram image in museum. So it's like whole dimensional image. Okay. Let me tell you three different groups of research and development of hologram. First of all, research centers. ETRI, KT, and KISS, all three are funded by government and run by government. ETRI is carrying out holographic 3D video system for acquisition and reconstruction of 3D information and basic technology based on digital holography. KT is carrying out high-speed CGH algorithm, holographic interactive system, depth camera 3D application software, and holographic printer. KISS is carrying out edges 3 image information obtained from microscope and digital hologram, and generates realistic 3D object combined real images. And university, Gwangun University is where I come from, is a promising university, carrying out high-speed CGH algorithm and digital holographic display of real objects, color video holographic stereogram. Also, Sejong University and Seoul National University and Korean National University of Arts are also carrying out research and development of hologram. Especially Korean National University of Arts are focusing on art. So many people, many students are making efforts to generate high resolution and high efficiency optical hologram. Companies, as I told you before, Samsung, LG, and Hangyu IC, three companies are focusing on hologram in Korea, especially Samsung. I think you all know about Samsung, and they are also making a lot of efforts on developing hologram. And I'm gonna give you a speech about one lens, one sensor array of full HD RGB depth combining sensing 3D camera on Thursday. This is developed by Samsung. Also, LG is carrying out digital hologram spatial light modulation technology, light source, and optic design technology. And lastly, Hangyu IC is a venture company in Korea, which carries out digital hologram recording optical engine and color holography technology. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Next is Portugal. Maria Isabel, here you are.
Good morning. The development of holography in Portugal has taken place in different laboratories located at the University of Porto, Aveiro, research centers and institutes. CLOC, Centro de Laser e Ótica Quântica, INETI, Instituto Nacional de Engenharia e Tecnologia Industrial, and in the State Printing Company, INCM, Imprensa Nacional Casa da Moeda. The research and development activities are supported by national and European programs involving national and international partners. The areas included in these activities are fundamental principles of holography and their application to optical processing, real-time holography in photorefractive crystals, pulse holography, holographic interferometry with applications to medicine and mechanical engineering, identification holographic tags with recorded image or coded information. Volume holography, indichromat, gelatin and polymers, and color control on white light holography. At the universities of Porto, Aveiro and Lisbon, the holographic principles and technologies are taught in graduate and undergraduate courses. Summer schools, seminars, talks and exhibitions are organized regularly to the specialists and the public in general. The Science Museum of University of Porto, the Fabrica, connected with University of Aveiro and programs like Ciência Viva, are all strongly promoting that kind of actions. One of strongest is the implementation of a net of basic holographic labs in secondary schools. Art holography has been implemented at the University of Aveiro and more recently at the University, no, sorry, first in the University of Porto and more recently at the University of Aveiro. The teams are composed by physicists and artists, and their objective is to obtain transmission and reflection holograms to be reconstructed with laser or white light, rainbow holograms and multi-image holograms having more deeply researched. Color control on reflection holography has been obtained by means of chemical methods other than the press-welding on silver halide photographic emulsions. Collaborations between University of Porto and De Montfort University, Leicester, UK, carry out developments in digital art holography. University of Porto has recently produced a transmission hologram with a reconstruction of 7 meters deep. Later, when I'm doing my presentation about the work, I will show you that a picture about a movie about that hologram I spoke now. I'm speaking. Thank you for your question.
Thank you. Do we have an attendee from the Russian Federation? Welcome. Let's see, Sweden. Oh, there you are, Nils.
So I'm sorry to say there is not so much to speak about holography in Sweden. There isn't happening so very much. One of the reasons could be that Hans Bjelkhagen left us. So he is very famous now, traveling around, speaking about learning, teaching people how to make color holograms. Another reason could be that I've left holography and started in relativity instead, because I find that holography and relativity are very much the same thing, which might surprise somebody. However, we are still happy in Sweden because Jonny Gustafsson is there. He stayed there and he is producing a holographic table. It's a table where the tabletop is covered by a hologram, and onto that tabletop there is a projection from many projectors. And it produces a three-dimensional image, which you can see there on the table. You can walk around the table, you can sit around the table and look at the things. And these images interaction table that present a computed generated autostereoscopic three-dimensional image that can be viewed and interacted with. So you see there on the table objects that don't exist, they have never existed, they are just made by the three-dimensional computers, and in this image you can do a lot of different work, and it is very useful for military command, medical imaging, city planning, surveying, scientific visualization, chemistry, and the number of calculations and educational applications. So that's what I have to say about Sweden's holography. Thank you.
Thank you. Switzerland.
Hello. In Switzerland, in terms of academy, there's not much work on direct holography, but most research institutes and universities, they focus more on microfabrication, while in the commercial world, most really holographies apply for optical document security, also in the company where I'm working. So to mention a few of the academics, there's the Institute CSCM. There's a group which was formerly led by Mike Gale, and they do serial order devices, and they do holograms on inserts used in injection molding, so mass fabrication of holograms. There's the Paul Scherrer Institute, where they do microfabrication, especially grayscale e-beam lithography, so that you could use for producing holograms. There is the 3D AG, they do origination for external partners, so they do holograms for any company that would like to use hot embossing, so they do that with conventional holography and also for example, with e-beam writing. And another company is OVD Kinogram, they do kinograms, they do holograms and other diffractive effects for IDs, passports, driving licenses, and they have even their own production facility. Then there are a few other companies which work on designing holograms, and they work together with external partners, for example, from India, and yeah, you can find them in the report that I submitted to Michael. Thank you.
Thank you. Taiwan.
Hi, good morning. My name is Yaling Huang. I'm from Kunshan University, Taiwan. And this morning, I'm glad I noticed another Taiwanese lady attend to this conference, Zhu Jingyu, right? Okay. This is my pleasure to give you some brief information about the developing of holography in Taiwan. And actually, everything started from the late 70s. And during that time, there are science part and arts part comes together. So from the, sorry about a few. Maybe we just see this way, it will be easier. Okay. From the science part, Dr. Hu was the first one to develop in holography lab in National Taiwan University. And during the same time, this artist called Yang Yingfeng was combined holography and art, especially in sculpture together in Taiwan. So the laboratory in National Taiwan University is getting important for the industrial part of the developing in holography. And so far, there are few companies that are focusing on the holography, especially on the security parts, which like K-Laser probably is more familiar with you. And the economy, there are a few universities in Taiwan that has some developing in holography, and most of them on technical and science part. And Kunshan University is the only one focusing on R&D design. Since the late 70s, there are some holography exhibitions in Taiwan and getting slower in the 90s. But since from the slide, we can see since 2008, more and more exhibitions happen in Taiwan. And sometimes it's very important to have exhibitions because it helps people to open the view about what is the holography also. And this year we have few holography exhibition happen. Like right now, Jonathan Rose, he is working on a holography exhibition in Taipei.
Martina also had his workshops in Kaohsiung Dadong Fine Art Museum. And during the end of this year, we're going to have another exhibition in Queensland University. So that's about my short brief information about how holography happened in Taiwan. Thank you.
I believe we have an attendee from Turkey. I'd like to extend our welcome. Hans will be representing the UK.
Okay, so I'm going to give you a brief report on United Kingdom. And actually, a lot of things are happening. We have several people from United Kingdom here talking about their own thing, so I will just briefly give a little survey of what is going on. Next slide, please. If we start in alphabetic order, Aberdeen University, we have John Watson working on his Holomar project. He is making underwater holography with studying plankton and other type of marine objects down to 100 meters under the sea, and he has been very successful. It's something in marine life preservation and studying and behavior of plankton. Next slide, please. Center for Modern Optics, where some of you have been in the symposium in 2006, and the Center for Modern Optics. When I retired, the center was closed, and there were some financial problems with the university. Ardi Usanlo, my colleague, is still there, but he's mainly teaching at the university. He will give a paper anyhow later, and so will I on Wednesday about many of this virtual artifact exhibition and color holography. So you will hear about that on Wednesday. And in most of my time since then, I have been working with David Radcliffe, writing a book on color holography, which will be out later this year. Next slide, please. Okay, color holographic, and Mike Medora is become a main player in color holography. He has, of course, developed his own material, the Bierenheide material, and has now made actually possibility to make panchromatic emulsions. You will hear more about that in my survey of color holography. One interesting product he has designed is this wooden box with integrated LED lights. So when you open it, you can display artifacts and color holograms in that box. It's an 8x10 size box. Next slide, please. Martin Richardson unfortunately couldn't make it here. He is a main player in digital art holography, and he works at the Montfort University. And we have some of his people working with him here from Portugal and so have been working. This is an example of one of his holograms he create and work together with Yola. Next slide, please. Jonathan Ross, Gallery 11, Gallery 286 in London. Unfortunately, Jonathan Ross is not able to come because he is in Taiwan setting up an exhibition. He may show up later this week, but it's not clear. Anyhow, he has organized exhibitions around England, and this is remarkable because people have never seen holograms in UK. The young generation will see these old 70s, 80s hologram and are extremely amazed. He has a huge collection, and you will have a brochure on his collection which you can pick up at the registration. So he brought this for you to get. Next slide. Also, another interesting thing has happened. Harman Technology, the former Ilford, has started to produce their old material again, the red and green sensitive silver halide. And you can now get them. They are not useful for color holography, but of course for normal monochrome, they are out and you can use them. Next slide, please. We have another person who is actually here, Javid Khan from Holaxia, he will show his mammoth hologram that was featured on Science magazine recently. And is that correct that you will show the hologram? In the museum, you will see his hologram. Okay. Then another artist that you well know is Inaki, who has he's working for Light Impression doing his security stuff. But also he has his own lab where he make beautiful pseudo-color holograms. He has been doing that for a long time. Next slide, please. Nottingham University and Andrew Pepper, he's actually here, and I believe he's going to tell you more of what he is doing. He has organized different exhibitions in Nottingham, and he has also been involved in international shows that he has been, as well as involved in teaching. But since he is here, I will let him talk more about his work. Next slide, please. That is... in South Korea, actually, there he had an exhibition. Another important thing in UK is, of course, Ian Lancaster and Reconnaissance International. Most of you are familiar with him. He was actually running the Holographic Museum for a while in New York, but now he's extremely successful running these professional conferences in security, Holopack, Holoprint. He also published Holography News, which I think is mainly in the people in commercial and security who subscribe on it. But anyhow, that paper exists, as well as he has this International Hologram Manufacturers Association, and that is to protect security holograms not to be copied. So you register your designs in there and become a member and have a code of practice how to operate security and be approved by the government and so on. Next slide. The Royal Photographic Society has a holography group, has had for a long time. We have now joined with the Stereoscopic Society, since there is so much interest in 3D in general, and formed RPS 3D Imaging and Holography Group with me as a chairman. And Graham Saxbier, whom you know very well, has resigned, and Alan Cooper is going to be the representative into the Royal Photographic Society for this holography group in the future. Next slide, please. We have another artist whom unfortunately couldn't attend, Pearl John, who was going to come here and give a paper, but unfortunately couldn't. So she is both artist and educator. She is running courses around UK, go to classrooms and teach holography, as well as she has her own studio in the university and create works of art there. This is an example of one of her pieces. Next slide, please. And finally, spatial imaging with Rob Mundy has made a lot of interesting things over many years. He's familiar, of course, with his LightGate and his digital hologram mastering systems. He is heavily involved in that producing. But also the most recent thing that has happened in UK is this Jubilee of the Queen. So 1st of June, Jersey issued a stamp with the first stamp of a holographic portrait ever put on a stamp, a 3D portrait by Rob Mundy. And next slide, please. So this is the stamp that was released 1st of June. It's based on this portrait that was mined in 2004 by Rob Mundy and Chris Levine. And this portrait is also exhibited. It may be in the MIT Museum, I don't know, but I know John Perry has been involved in it as well, but this is an embossed hologram on the stamp, a 10-pound stamp, and Betsy Connors is supposed to put it up here at the back for you to see with some information. And I think, yes, so this is more or less what I have to report, and this is the most recent thing. Okay, thank you.
Here, on things are connected. Which brings us to the United States. The big news, of course, being ISDH and the MIT Museum exhibition, The Jeweled Net, Views of Contemporary Holography. In the interest of time, I'm going to compress my report a bit. Other recent U.S. holographic imaging conferences included, of course, SPIE's Photonics West, January 2012 in San Francisco, the OSA's Digital Holography and Three-Dimensional Imaging Conference, which was April in Miami. But it's interesting because presentations on display holography have been turning up at other events, including SID's Display Week, which was here in Boston 2 weeks ago, had a session on holographic imaging. The Society of Motion Picture and Television Engineers annual conference on stereoscopic 3D for media and entertainment in New York had several presentations on display holography. The OSA had a 3D display technology perception and application incubator meeting, which I was one of the hosts of in Washington this spring, and there were presentations on display holography there. In terms of research, academic research in holographic imaging, particularly digital methods, continues very strongly in the U.S. Recent papers were published by groups from at least Duke University, Harvard, Michigan Technological University, MIT, the University of Arizona, the University of Colorado, the University of Connecticut, and Virginia Polytechnic Institute. In terms of industry, hologram remains a powerful marketing word, even if it seems increasingly to be applied to things that aren't really holograms. The most recent example, of course, is the supposed hologram of the deceased performer Tupac, which made an appearance on stage in April at the Coachella Valley Music and Arts Festival. Paula and I have both been quoted in many articles about that. I will note that since then, I have been contacted by the people who own the rights to digital recreations of Marilyn Monroe. I won't be working with them. We are probably at some point going to at least make a Pepper's Ghost that's 3D and autostereoscopic just to show how it ought to look if you're going to do that sort of thing. In the past 12 months, there have been over 200 US patents related to display holography, interestingly, including one or two from MIT. The big news in the holography business in the US, of course, continues to be Zebra Imaging. Who somehow or other managed to keep going year after year. My congratulations. Other people I'll note include Ravel, and interestingly, they've provided holograms to a startup called HoloTouch. And HoloTouch, which you can look up on the web, makes holographic push buttons, where an image of the button or buttons floats out in the air, and there's a proximity sensor that detects your finger intersecting with the image so that you don't actually have to touch a physical button to turn things on and off. And there's a lot more going on, but I don't want to take any more time from TJ. Are there attendees from any other nations that we've missed here? Well, we got them all. So welcome to people from every nation. And with that, we're going to move to the portion of our program relating to holography and education. And opening it with a double-length paper is perennial favorite TJ.